Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's Heidelberg Joint Astronomy Colloquium. It is a real pleasure and an honor today to have Connie Aerts with us giving today's colloquium. Connie is a world-leading expert, as all of you probably know, on stellar evolution, stellar structure, on variable stars, and above all, of course, she is a pioneer of astroseismology, and in particular over the past two decades using Cordot, Kepler, and TESS. Connie obtained her PhD in 1993 from KU Leuven. After that, she obtained a postdoctoral fellowship of the Research Foundation of Flanders. And since 2001, she is a permanent faculty at Leuven, first as a lecturer, but then in 2007, she became a full professor. And between 2011 and 2019, she was actually the director of the Institute of Astronomy there. Next to that, since 2004, she has been holding a professorship in astroseismology in Nijmegen. And since 2019, Connie is actually kind of a local here because she is an external scientific member of the Max Planck Gesellschaft, which she holds at MPIA. And then in addition, she's held guest professorships in Hasselt, Utrecht, and Leiden. Right now, she holds an ERC advanced grant, and I'm sure we're going to hear results from that project. And I think I'm going to stop there because I would probably need the entire colloquium slot to mention all prizes and honors that Connie has received. So with that, I would like to give the floor to you, Connie, for your talk on space astroseismology, the renaissance of stellar interiors. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Diederik, for this kind introduction. Hello, Heidelberg. It's so good to be with you, even if only virtual. But we take care these days. I hope you're all fine. And I'm very happy that I am given the opportunity, let's say, to give you an update on astroseismology. So let me try to share my screen with you. Okay, then we are ready to go. So without further ado, let me start, and I have to say that several of you have probably heard me give talks before, and so I might be repeating myself a little bit, but I always assign great value to introduce the field for the non-expert, particularly focused to junior researchers and students, so I'm going to do that again today. I'm also Belgian, as you know, so I have to have at least one word in the title that is French, so I will pronounce it a little bit differently than Diederik just did, Renaissance. That means rebirth, right? And so I'm really calling upon astroseismology as a new way to look at stars. Now, what is the take-home message, if there is one? A thing that I would like you to be reminded of this talk is that stellar oscillations really give us a new way to look at stars. We look deep in their interior as if we were to measure there locally. And so just like the seismologists of the Earth, as you see here in the seismograph, manage to use earthquakes and the waves they create to learn something about the interior of our planets, we're going to do that to stars. And this has become possible thanks to space missions. Yeah? For the moment, we are swarmed with data. We have many more stars to analyze than astrophysicists to do it. So if any of you feels that this is an appealing opportunity, please join us. We have been from the start an inclusive group of astrophysicists, and also that is something really important for me. Okay, the art is going to be to get the physics out of the light curves that are being assembled by the space missions. Yeah. I'm going to focus mostly on the Kepler mission because that simply gave us the longest term light curves so far. So why do we want to bother with this at all to start with? Well, stellar evolution is a quite, established field in astrophysics. As you see here on this cartoon, stars get born, they live their life, and they lead us to three possible end products. It's fairly well understood. But if we look at the details, this is less so. And so what do we typically do with stellar astrophysicists? we consider a Hertzsprung-Russell diagram where we plot the luminosity of the star as a function of the effective temperature. We have all these theoretical predictions from computer models mimicking stars. We place our observed stars on there and we check if the theory is actually correct with the data. Now, these data are very often what I call classical data. So that's information coming from the surface of the star, like effective temperatures, like abundances, like rotation frequencies, well, rather not rotation velocities from the surface of the star, right? And so astroseismology really brings us a new dimension, so to speak, because we get information really from the deep interior of the star. And as always, if you open up a new window, then you're going to get surprises, nice surprises, nice for some people, less nice for others. I'm one of those astrophysicists who can get really excited if we see that the theory doesn't work, because that means we will be able to learn something. Yeah, it's also nice to confirm, of course, theoretical predictions. But for me personally, that's a bit more limited. So let's see where astroseismology brings us, right? So my favorite version of the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram is the one on the left here, where you see an indication of all the phases throughout the evolution of stars in these colored ellipses here, where stars have oscillations. Yeah, and you see these ellipses are almost all over the place, not everywhere. It's also a matter of time scales when you can catch a star during its oscillatory phase. But we have a good handle in the sense that stellar evolution theory can be tested because we have various stars in various phases that have actually non-radial oscillations. Yeah. Now, we're going to do in this talk a pragmatic approach, as I call it, in the sense that we're going to use the oscillations that the stars give us. I'm not going to go into the details of why these stars have their oscillations. I can do that in the question session if you like. But for the time being, let's be pragmatic and let's use the attitude like, what can oscillations teach us more than classical data such as spectroscopy, interferometry, astrometry, and of course Heidelberg is very much focused on Gaia in the various teams, so I'm also going to try to make a connection to that, right? Now, let's look at this stellar evolution theory. It tells us how a star lives its life, and I'm going to focus on the longest, let's say, time sequences in life. That's when stars have nuclear burning in their center, or in shells, either hydrogen or helium burning. Yeah? This covers almost all stellar life. So I'm not going to focus on the final end products, even though I know there are major experts in this audience, but you can ask them then to focus on that aspect. The reason is very simple. We need to detect stellar oscillations before we can do astroseismic modeling. That's obvious. And in the very final phases, well, we don't have the opportunity, either because the stars have a too strong wind and we cannot detect the oscillations, or because the life phases are too short, yeah, and it's instantaneous explosions, okay? Now, during these nuclear burning phases, if we consider the interior of stars, what we actually want to do is like what I've tried to mimic in this blue cartoon. We would like to grab pieces of the interior of the star and see how the rotation behaves there, how the chemical mixing behaves there, if there is strong interior magnetism, etc., how the convection works. Yeah. So if we are really, let's say, honest, then we have theories for that, well-developed theories, I would even say, but they have not been calibrated by in situ measurements of how these processes in the deep interior of the star work, right? And that is what the oscillations bring us, okay? So let's look at this cartoon, huh? Non-radial oscillation modes, well, what you actually do, you see here various representations in the upper graph of different oscillations, yeah? You have your spherical star in the easiest approximation, and you perturb it, and these perturbations, they happen periodically in the eigenfrequencies of the gaseous sphere. Yeah? And these perturbations, since we're perturbing a sphere, happen with spherical harmonic functions. Huh? That's the most appropriate set of basis functions to describe it, and that's what we do. Now you see in these different cartoons here, yeah, you see blue and red parts of the star, and that's just to mimic that at this phase in the oscillation cycle, let's say, the blue parts are actually moving towards you as an observer, while the red parts are moving away from you. So in this Doppler map, as we call it, blue parts, they create a blue shift in the light, and the red parts, they create a red shift. And throughout the oscillation cycle, each of these modes has its own periodicity with which it's oscillating around equilibrium. Yeah, and you see also white nodal lines. These are parts in the stellar surface that don't move. And we describe them with the spherical harmonic coupled to Legendre polynomial. Yeah. Now in the lower panels, you see what I actually wanted to do graphically. Yeah, I want to use these oscillations on the sphere, but to go to the interior. Because of course, an oscillation mode is actually a displacement. It creates displacements in 3D. Yeah. So once we are able to understand how it works at the stellar surface, we can then infer how it works in the interior. And the way it works in the interior, the value of the frequency of these modes, well, this is connected to the physical circumstances, yeah? And that's how astroseismology actually works. So we need both a surface measurement, and we use the surface measurement of the oscillations to infer how it works in the interior, yeah? Now, if you look at data from such star quakes, as they are called in popular talks, like here, you see a light curve here assembled by the Kepler mission of NASA. And so what you see on the upper y-axis is relative brightness as a function of time. And you see the star moving up and down and up and down. And you see the seismographic signal, just as for the seismographs on Earth. Yeah. So as I said, we cannot deduce the stellar surface, except if we have some interferometric data of really big stars, but in general, the stars are just point sources. And we have to infer how the oscillations behave from a light curve. Yeah. So at the stellar surface, I'm going to turn on an animation here so that you know what I mean. So the star is quaking, is going up and down, has seismic activity. And from the light curve, we can hope to derive the oscillation frequencies. And that will be tuned towards the physics of the interior, because the oscillation frequency is connected to the physical condition inside the entire star. That is just the same as the frequencies of a musical instrument. When you can hear it, well, you have to basically sit inside the concert hall, let's say. Well, that's our oscillation cavity in the case of sound waves. Well, some of the stellar oscillations also create sound waves that propagate through the interior gas of the star. So that's actually our concert hall, let's say. So to speak, yeah. And so once you can hear the frequency of the oscillation, once you can detect it in the light curve, you can use that information to get to know your musical instrument better. Huh? So you could also say that astroseismology is the music of the stars. So that's sometimes how I call it, yeah. Now for us, the oscillation frequencies are way easier to deduce if we move from the time series domain, as you see in the upper graph of the light curve, towards the frequency domain. And so this has been done to come to the lower graph here on the slides, where you see all these black bars here. These are the oscillation frequencies of this particular star. Now, this is the Fourier transform, not of this curve, which is only about 15 days long. In reality, Kepler measured 200 stars in a particular area of the sky during 1500 days. Huh? But to show the analogy with how a seismograph detects Earth oscillations, let's say, I've blown it up to 15 days. Also because you then see nicely that there is a beating pattern. So this star does not have just one oscillation mode. No, it has plenty, hundreds of them that are moving up and down the star at the same time, and it gives a positive and a negative interference at some phases. Huh? So here is a positive interference, here is a negative one, etc. And so if you transform that to Fourier space, then you're actually using that these normal oscillation modes, which are sinusoidal variations, as you know, a sine function, if you Fourier transform it, then you get a delta function, a peak at the frequency of that particular mode. So all these peaks here are fairly well visible for your maybe not so expert eye, but in any case, you see that there is a whole bunch of oscillation frequencies for this star. And for this particular star, the maximum amplitude occurs near 75 microhertz, right? So that is immediately connected to the size of the stars, and I'll come back to that later, all right? Now let's do just a little bit of mathematics here. So every stellar oscillation is a non-radial perturbation from a spherical star, which is actually a solution of stellar structure and evolution equations. You have all learned that in your bachelor or master education, right? So the stellar structure equations just express conservation laws in physics, and your gaseous sphere has to fulfill them. We perturb them periodically, and then we come to spherical harmonics, as I've shown them in cartoon-like style, let's say. Now, depending on your interests in stars, you're going to have to, or you're going to want to, simplify the stellar structure equation that we are going to use here, and that's the equation of motion. Yeah, in the simplest case of a non-rotating, non-magnetic, single star, your two most important forces that occur in the equation of motion are the pressure force and gravity, yeah? At least when your star is not too massive, okay? Now you can make that more complex depending on your particular interest, and you can make your star rotate, yeah? In that case, you introduce the Coriolis and the centrifugal forces. Or you want to make your star magnetic. In that case, you introduce the Lorentz force, right? Or your star may be a closed binary that is subject to tidal forces. Yeah. So depending on how many of these forces you include, your non-radial oscillation theory is going to be more complex, evidently, right? Now, I've put these five forces here, and three of them are in red. And that has a specific reason. Yeah, that's because these forces, we could only study their consequences in terms of the waves created by the non-radial oscillations. Since the Kepler mission, essentially, we could discover waves that are connected to these forces as restoring forces already in the Coral data as well. So Coral was a precursor mission, you could say, of Kepler, but it only observed the stars during 5 months, while Kepler observed the stars during 4 years. And so the precision with which we can measure oscillation frequencies goes as 1/1 the total time base of the time series of the brightness variations. So obviously 1/4 years gives a much better frequency precision than 1/5 months. Yeah. And so when the buoyancy force is the dominant restoring force, or the Coriolis force or tidal forces, you immediately end up with waves that have frequencies connected to periods of the order of days. Right. And so periods with the order of days are extremely difficult to study from Earth, because we ourselves live in a rhythm that is connected to a day. And so that makes it extremely difficult to detect non-radial oscillations with a period of a day. Imagine you go to your telescope every night and you observe with a high precision instrument, either velocity or brightness, but you do it every day at the same time. Well, if your oscillation cycle has a period of one day, you measure a constant star, right? So it is particularly for these long period oscillation modes that space photometry is very important. You are not interrupted by the daily cycle, and you need a long time series, okay? So all these forces, each of these forces, they have their own importance in restoring the behavior of the modes, huh? While they are perturbing periodically from equilibrium and from the waves they are connected to. And so the sun, for instance, has acoustic waves, yeah? Its non-radial oscillation modes have periods of the order of minutes. These are sound waves, and that is a high frequency signal, yeah? Now, other stars have other quakes, yeah? Sound waves are pressure modes. We call them P modes because the dominant restoring force is the pressure force. If the dominant restoring force is gravity, then we speak of G modes. Yeah? They are in a much lower frequency regime. And you see that here in this simplified cartoon, where this line here sort of gives the whole range of frequencies that you can have. And the easiest cases are the high frequency cases. Why? Because that's in a frequency regime where the Coriolis force and the Lorentz force and the centrifugal forces can be ignored. And so then the theory of stellar oscillations is way easier. That's what the sun is delivering us as an application case. And so that's the easiest case. The more we go to lower frequencies, the more difficult it gets, because phenomena like the Coriolis force and the Lorentz force, or the tidal force if you're in closed binaries, they cannot be ignored in the force balance that is expressed by the equation of motion, right? So try to recall, high frequency oscillations, we can ignore rotation. That's fantastic because it's an immense simplification. What does that mean? Well, it also will mean that you will have some limitations on what you can deduce in terms of rotation, okay? And so the same is true for magnetism, for instance, right? So in our quest to deduce interior phenomena of stars, well, depending on what you want to deduce, you're gonna either have to work with pressure, want to work with pressure modes if you can afford the simplicity, or you're gonna have to deal with gravity modes. And some stars have oscillation modes that have a bit of the two, where both the pressure force and the gravity modes, gravity force, come into play in the restoring force balance. We call these mixed modes. These are very interesting, and we have found these. It's one of the major discoveries. Yeah. What is the difference if you look at displacements between pressure and gravity modes? Well, here on the upper three graphs, you see curves, and these are three eigenvectors of an oscillation mode, right? So in green, you see the simplest of the simplest, a radial oscillation mode. What does that mean in terms of a sphere? Up and down and up and down, yeah? This is purely radial motion. So the radial displacement here is the green curve, yeah? And the tangential displacement for a radial mode, well, it's flat at zero because it's a radial mode, yeah, by definition. Now this red curve here is a non-radial mode, but it's still a pressure mode. So an acoustic wave, yeah? Acoustic waves have dominantly radial displacements. You see that because the red curve here, it's normalized to one at the surface, yeah? So either you measure it in velocity or in brightness, as you wish. Huh? If you look at the tangential displacements of an acoustic mode, you see it's still flat at zero. At this scale, you can't even see that it's different from zero. It is, but only slightly so. And why is it invisible? Because the plot is tuned towards this blue eigenvector, and that's a gravity mode, a dipole gravity mode, because the L value gives you the number of wide bands that occur on the surface, right? And so for this eigenfunction here inside the star, this blue curve has about 20 nodes, and we label the number of nodes by an n value. If it's gravity modes, it gets a negative value. If it's pressure modes, it gets a positive value. This is just an agreement you have to make, so to speak, in your theoretical description. And what you see here is that gravity modes, well, they have dominant tangential displacement. So their motion is dominated in perpendicular planes touching upon your sphere. Yeah. And so as you see here, this is dominant in this graph. And not zero at all, but smaller in this graph. It's almost a factor 10 difference in importance of the tangential versus the radial displacement. Now, what does that mean? These displacement components, you actually take them together to obtain the probing capacity of a mode. That's what we call the probing kernel, and you see it in this graph here. And so the blue curve, the dominant gravity mode here, has its probing power mainly in the inner part of this star. This is for a two solar mass star, which has a convective core. And so there's no propagation possible in this convective core because the gravity modes, they have a frequency below the buoyancy frequency of your star. Okay. And then the pressure modes, as you see here, they are dominant in the outer envelope of the star. So pressure modes, acoustic waves, they tune mainly the physics of envelopes of stars. Gravity modes, they tune mainly the physics of the inner regions of stars. So in terms of unknowns in physics of stellar evolution, well, I'm more of a fan of such blue oscillation modes, because they probe in the deeper layers of stars. Yeah. In the lower two graphs, you see propagation cavities of a star. So what you see here is on the y-axis, the frequency, the cyclic frequency of each of the modes. And on the x-axis, it is expressed as a function of position inside the star. Yeah. This blue area is the cavity, the mode cavity of the gravity modes, of the G modes. So all the G modes and all these black dots here are eigenfrequencies of this particular stellar model. All these modes can only propagate in the area of the star below the Brund-Weissel frequency, which is indicated by this full line here. Yeah. In orange, you see the acoustic mode cavity. So there you have all the modes that are dominantly restored by the pressure force. So these are sound waves with one node, with two nodes, with three nodes, etc. They haven't been drawn with a higher number of nodes here. So in these orange regions of the stars here, acoustic waves propagate. And you see that for a star on the main sequence, like this is an F-type star, so an intermediate mass star, you see that the acoustic mode cavity is quite disjoint from the G-mode cavity. Yeah? In between is a white area, it's the evanescent zone, where both of these waves would tend to damp out. They are not periodic, they're not an eigen solution of your perturbed equation. But as a star evolves, so this star now will evolve to become a red giant, then it gets this type of mode cavity. So what you see here is that the acoustic mode cavity becomes bigger in a bigger portion of the star, while the G mode cavity becomes a bit narrower. And the evanescent white zone in between becomes way smaller. So as a consequence, the modes that can propagate in the orange area and in the blue area, well, if this zone is tiny, then they can couple to each other. And they have then both a pressure and a gravity character. So we call these mixed modes, mixed non-radial modes, and dipole modes are very good at that. So in a red giant star, it is very advantageous to be able to detect and identify dipole modes, because they can have a pressure mode character here, a gravity mode character here, and they then probe the entire star. And that's really an asset, right? Now, with this background, how do we work in our daily practice? On the one hand, we have observations, space astroseismology, loads of light curves in the Kepler case, 4 years. TESS continuous viewing zone is delivering us 1 year light curves now in its sectors, 27 days. And then we had to refurbish the Kepler mission K2, which looked at the ecliptic for 3 months. We also have spectroscopy either from the ground in this case, either time series spectroscopy, but very often just one spectrum or a few. And we have the magnificent Gaia mission that is helping us nowadays, bringing us astrometry. The whole point is, of course, to find the stars that are in these ellipses that I showed in the beginning. And with that, we have a whole battery of machine learning algorithms to find us from the light curves, do pattern recognition, help us in finding our stars that oscillate. That's a whole lecture by itself. I will not go into that detail, but we can find those that oscillate. Just take that from. Yeah, that gives us sort of observed chemistry, as I call it, surface abundances, for instance. It gives us luminosities from the astrometry, for instance, and it gives us the oscillation frequencies from Fourier transforms of the light curves. Yeah. On the other hand, we have theory. We have stellar structure and evolution theory. And it, in its simplest formulation, if we were to know it perfectly well, this has four unknowns: the mass of the star, the age of the star, and its initial composition, where we usually give the birth hydrogen fraction, the birth helium fraction, or the birth hydrogen fraction and the metallicity, and then the other one results. So we have, for the perfect knowledge of interior physics, four parameters to determine. These four, yeah? We compute a stellar model, assuming that our input physics is perfect. Yeah, we perturb that spherical stellar model if it's a non-rotating non-magnetic star, and we get predictions for the oscillation frequencies from the theory. And of course, we want to match these two. Now, in order to be able to do that, we must, of course, know which oscillation modes are in the data in order to couple them to the theoretical predictions in terms of the frequency and the spherical harmonic that is connected to that particular eigenmode, right? So I would say, before we go to applications, there are two types of astroseismologists. Huh? There are those of us who want to use astroseismology to help other astrophysicists, right? By providing the mass of the star, the age of the star, and the radius with a higher precision than classical data can do it. That's, let's say, one application that you can do. And then there are people like me who are more in the second category, who try to improve the input physics of stellar interiors. And for that, we're going to see how well standard theory can explain the measured oscillation frequencies once we have identified oscillation modes. So we have to come up, and this is an important point here, that's why it's in red, we have to come up not only with the frequencies in the data, but we also have to find a way to identify which spherical harmonic belongs to which frequency, because else you cannot couple the theory to the data. And once you do that, you will, of course, find that there is no perfect match. Huh? It's an illusion to think that we had it all right, because this input physics box here has about 200 unknown parameters, or we don't admit they are parameters, but we don't know very well what to take. And this goes back also to atomic physics limitations, to limitations in nuclear physics, but also to phenomena that we don't know very well, like rotation, magnetism, tides, etc. Okay, so in wandering through this diagram, we can really learn a lot. Yeah? So let's do some applications now for the rest of the talk. And I'm going to start with the easiest cases. Remember the frequency line that I have told you about, yeah? And then we will gradually build up the challenges, let's say, all right? So first, let's go and look at the sun. That's the star we know best, right? This is the solar oscillation spectrum. I still find it magnificent to look at it every day. Here is the power of the solar oscillation frequencies as a function of frequency, and this comes from SOHO. You see here beautiful oscillation peaks, all nice delta peaks, you know, Fourier transforms of sinusoidal variability of the sun, and the sun has acoustic modes. These waves are dominantly restored by the pressure force, and the sun is nicely spherical because it's a very slow rotator to my standards, okay? So remember, in that case, you can basically ignore the rotation in the force balance, and you can also ignore the Lorentz force. The sun is magnetic. It has a strong magnetic field, you could say, but the Lorentz force, in terms of restoring force, is really negligible. Yeah? And then you see all these beautiful oscillation modes here, and the strongest modes, they peak at a frequency that is about 3000 microhertz. Yeah, 3000 microhertz, if you're unfamiliar with this field, if you invert that, then you get the oscillation period of the dominant oscillations of the sun. So that's about 5 minutes, right? So the solar quakes, so to speak, they go up and down with periodicities of minutes. And then there are loads of them, hundreds of them, but the overall, you know, beating pattern is typically a couple of weeks if you ignore the rotation and the magnetism, right? Now, since these are sound waves, their regularity here, all these frequencies are connected to the sound speed in the solar interior. And you see that there is a really nice regular pattern. That pattern is what we call the large frequency separation, and it is an inverted integral of the sound speed inside the sun, right? So we have measured the maximum frequency of the oscillations, a regularity that is coupled to the sound speed. And if you look carefully here, there's also a regularity, a small peak, a large peak, a small peak, a large peak, a small peak, a large peak. That's what we call the small frequency separation. And that is not connected to the sound speed itself, but the gradient of the sound speed. So this directly tells you where or the value of the gradient of the sound speed. Now, why is there a gradient in the sound speed? Well, there is a large change in the sound speed when you move from the helium core of the sun towards the area where there is no nuclear burning, where it's still the pristine birth material. So the sound speed gradient is directly connected to the area inside the sun where there is helium production. And that is a unique measure of the age, right? So if you measure three values, so to speak, the frequency of maximum power, the regular frequency spacing between these modes of, let's say, the same degree, and the small frequency separation, these three numbers basically come from your data. They tell you how big the star is and how the sound speed behaves. The sound speed is connected to the density. If you integrate the density, you have the mass. Yeah. If you have the sound speed gradient, you know how old it is, right? So these are basic quantities that we can derive for other stars as well. And here is, again, a school book example. This is 16SigA, a solar-like star. Is it a copy of the sun? Well, you can have a look at this graph here. These are the star quakes of 16SigA. It is very much like the sun in signal, if you look at this upper graph here particularly, but the maximum is not at 3000 microhertz, it's at about 2200 and something microhertz. What does that mean? Yeah, these are acoustic waves inside a concert hall, 16SigA, right? And the frequency of maximum power has a bit lower frequency. If your frequency is a bit lower, your musical instrument is bigger. Yeah. So 16SigA is not at this value of precision a copy of the sun. It would be in spectroscopy. It's not at this, the level of astroseismology. It's a bit bigger star, right? And here you see a zoom in on how rotation changes the signal. Yeah. So I said there is, of course, rotation also in the sun. We measure rotation. The effect of rotation implies a splitting of the oscillation frequencies That's just as how music would change its frequency when the musicians would be on a rotating podium. It would not sound nice because of the shift in the oscillation frequencies, right? Well, that shift for this type of star is in the area of nanohertz, right? And that's why you can ignore it if you just want to size your star, if you want to weigh your star, determine its mass, or if you want to determine its gravity seismically, huh? You only have to know, in fact, the frequency of maximum power. So we use these scaling relations, assuming that we know perfectly well the physics of these stars. We assume it's the same like the sun, and that's logical. Low mass dwarfs, huh, on the main sequence, well, they all have an outer convective envelope, just like the sun. So it's absolutely fine. Yeah, they're all slow rotators because magnetic braking has slowed them down, just like the sun. Huh? So you can actually assume that they adhere to the same physics than the sun. And then you have a high precision radius and mass and age. Now you see here the radius and mass precision relatively is of the order of 1 to 2%. The age is 20%. It's a factor 10 larger. Why? Because that depends on the interior physics. And we're not tuning it when we use scaling relations because we freeze it, right? So that's why there, for the aging, there is a larger uncertainty. But an age precision of 10 to 20% is still magnificent. Huh? Just for a field star in the galaxy, it's very difficult to get an age, right? And that, of course, is of interest for exoplanet hunters. Huh? They can typically, if they have a host star measurement in space photometry, improve the radius of their exoplanet host with a factor 2 if they have a seismic measurement of their host star. Yeah, and so that's a major asset, yeah, as you see indicated here. But what is probably the even more important asset, huh, is the aging of the host star for those who want to search for habitability or understand it. Now, this is a graph from Ashley Chontos, a PhD student in Hawaii, who represented the radius of a planets, of exoplanets, as a function of the period, period of the planet. And so all these gray symbols here are discovered planets by now. The colored ones are host stars. Or at least our planets circling around host stars, where she managed to do astroseismology, and then you really get an improved factor 2 radius. There are many, many publications in this obviously very interesting field. Another field where the astroseismic aging is important is galactic archaeology, which actually started by the Corot mission, because Corot measured for 5 months, but it looked at different areas in the sky. And red giants are the application domain here. They all have a convective envelope. They have what we call solar-like acoustic modes or mixed modes, as I explained. And these allow to use scaling relations also to determine the mass and the radius, but above all, also the age. And of course, that's a component that is very hard to get if you're doing galaxy formation structure in general, right? And so the astroseismic ages are really an asset in this field. And the excellent, nice thing is, I'm showing here actually a plot from Dennis Stello's work where we have red giants from the K2 mission, which only observed for 3 months. And you see higher frequencies all the way up to lower frequencies. This is stellar evolution in action. A small red giant, which is a bit weird of an expression. And as you go upwards, the star climbs up the RGB, right? And so this has been amazingly successful also because once you have a mass, a radius, and you have spectroscopy that gives you an effective temperature, well, then you have a luminosity. And so actually we can measure seismic distances. And this goes remarkably well along with Gaia astrometry distance measurements. Okay, let me move on now to some internal physics because I'm talking too long as usual, but that's because I'm always fascinated by this field. So here we move on to higher mass stars, stars that have convective cores in their center, and their physics is not so well known. And it also doesn't make sense to scale the sun because the sun doesn't have a convective core and you cannot use scaling relations in a meaningful way. Moreover, these stars do not have a convective envelope. They have gravity modes. Yeah. And here are seven of them, again, with light curves from Kepler. And you see their Fourier transform in red plotted on top of this. Now, for someone like me who studies this star for more than 10 years, you see that the dominant starquake signal goes from lower to higher frequency here. This is not a sizing because these are not acoustic modes. These are gravity modes. And the fact that your dominant frequency shift is purely a matter of rotation because these modes are affected by the Coriolis force. So now we enter a regime where we have to complicate our stellar structure equation, but that also means that you can learn something from it. Yeah. And so what can we learn? Well, we can learn interior rotation. So if you look at these measurements, you actually have a direct assessment of the interior rotation of a star. And this is expressed here. So we're not looking at regularity in frequencies now, but regularity in periods of the modes. And for a non-rotating star, you see that regularity expressed here. So this is the difference in periods between modes of consecutive radial order, so the same degree L, the same M value, and the number of nodes in the interior is just different by one as you move from one dot to the next. Yeah. For a non-rotating star, you expect to see this flat period spacing pattern. And now we turn on the Coriolis force. And then you, what do? Your star rotates. And so your period of your mode, these are prograde modes, modes that travel along the rotation. So if your wave travels along the rotation, yeah, then it comes back to you faster, right? Because it helps the rotation. And so the period is then a bit shorter. So you move to the left in this diagram. And if your periods of the modes are shorter, then the period differences are also shorter. So you move to the lower part. And so a rotating star with gravity modes has a tilted pattern in period spacings. And the stronger the rotation, the higher the tilt of this pattern. So by composing such a pattern, I have a direct measurement of the rotation frequency in the area of the star where these modes have their dominant power. And as you have seen from my eigenfunctions, that's straight near the core of the star. So by looking at this, we have the near core rotation frequency of a star. I find that magnificent. Every day, we can't do this for the sun. We can do it for stars that offer us gravity modes. And these are the ones that have a convective core and a radiative envelope, right? Now the envelope rotation you can also measure, but since I'm running out of time, I'm going to focus on the core structure here. Do real stars do this? Yes, they do. This is a real star measured by Kepler. The amplitude spectrum as a function of periods of the modes now, not frequency. And to guide your eye, you see the regularity by these red dashed lines. All these star quakes, all these oscillation modes are of consecutive radial order and they have a tilted period spacing pattern. And from measuring the slope, I know what the rotation frequency is, right? Now, this star is a bit special. You always pick your best examples because it also has oscillations, huh? The same star where you plot them at higher periods and this goes up. Why? Because this star has both prograde modes that travel along the rotation, but also retrograde modes that travel against the rotation. And there you have the opposite reasoning. Huh? It takes longer before you get them back into your line of sight. So the periods increase and the period spacings also increase. So an upward diagram immediately tells me these are retrograde waves, right? And so in this application, you really need the Coriolis force. But once you do that, then you can handle on, then you get a handle on the interior rotation of the star. And this is what I've summarized in this diagram, already more than a year old now. The core rotation, near core rotation frequency as a function of the seismic gravity across stellar evolution. These are main sequence stars. These are red giants where we do this from the mixed modes. Remember, they couple to the interior of the star. And these are white dwarfs. And so if you look at this, this is a bit unpopulated here. But what we have discovered is that the rotation theory is not really appropriate the core rotation, once a star evolves to become an evolved star, a giant, your core shrinks, it spins up, your outer layers expand, they slow down. But the spinning of the core is about two orders of magnitude lower than what we had anticipated from our classical theory of stellar evolution. Yeah? Now, this is an update of the plots. About 1,800 stars, meanwhile, for the main sequence, just for you. Yeah, and all these stars, we have measured their interior rotation. For some of them, for a limited number, we have both the core and the envelope rotation, core rotation from the gravity modes, envelope rotation from the pressure modes, just like in the solar type star, right? And that gives you this plot where you have the main sequence stars. They're almost all near rigidity. And this is not what you get if you follow classical theory. Then in the subgiant and the red giant branch, your rotation in the core increases with respect to the outer layers. This is what we see. Huh? This is the core rotation. This is the outer layer rotation. But then when they are in the red clump, core helium burning, again, it is moving towards rigidity. So what we see here in this graph, this is a new version. Yeah. Well, when stars have a convective core, they move towards rigidity. And so this requires our tuning, our improvement of stellar oscillation theory. And there are basically two mechanisms based on magnetism or on internal gravity waves that transport angular momentum away from the core towards the outer layers to balance this rotation towards a more rigid rotation. Right? There are experts in this audience who are very familiar with these types of hydrodynamical simulations and angular momentum transport mechanisms. So let me move on just the last minutes to my third part, which is about mixing. This is all new. It's not yet in the literature. And so why is it important? Well, element mixing, chemical mixing really drives the lives of the star in the sense that it determines how much matter can take part in the convective core in the nuclear burning, right? So we know that chemical species change over time thanks to nuclear burning. We know that from atomic physics. Thanks to microscopic physics, such as heavier elements sink, like metals would sink, lighter elements would levitate, right? That's microscopic atomic diffusion. But on top of that, you have macroscopic motions, of which rotation is the most dominant one. But there's also waves that can mix your material. Magnetism has an influence on how material mixes. So it's all a matter of determining how much matter can enter into this core to know how the chemical nuclear burning protection works. And we, in an equation, we have this complex transport equation that is in our computer models to mimic stellar evolution. Yeah. Now, if we are honest, then we don't know how these coefficients work, because we cannot derive all these mixing phenomena based on first principles. So what astroseismology offers now is to assess how this mixing profile inside the star must behave, because the oscillations, they sort of feel this mixing when they determine their frequency, right? And so this element mixing is in fact of vast importance and a major unknown. So what have we done now lately? We have taken mixing profiles that are schematically represented here. This is just this equation from the previous slide, but in a nicer cartoon. And gray is the fully mixed convective core. Blue is sort of the transition layer between the fully mixed convective core and the radiative envelope, where there's only maybe microscopic mixing or maybe macroscopic rotational mixing. Who knows, right? We can't really deduce that from classical data, except that it has been tuned from surface abundances, where matter that is produced here makes it all the way to the surface. But of course, if you have only just an abundance measurement at the surface, it's very difficult to reconstruct how it got there. Yeah. So we have made 8 grids of stellar models with evolutionary computations, predicted their oscillations, compared to these two stars with a star oscillation measurement from Kepler, and see what we get out. And a summary is in this table. And then you actually see, you know, depending on how hard, where this envelope mixing is stitched to the transition area, you can or cannot bring this matter into the core or not. And this determines the life duration on the main sequence and also the mass of the helium core. Yeah. Now for solar type stars, we can't do this. They don't have G modes, right? You need G modes for this. For F-type stars, we can do this, and it has been done for about 40 stars now. And we see that their mixing in the envelope is pretty low, typically below this value that you see here. But for the B stars, and this is known, they are much faster rotators because they're not slowed down by magnetic braking. They have no outer convective envelope. We have a high variety of mixing levels that we see in about 30 of these stars. So for this, this is magnificent first step. It cannot be but a first step because our inspiration of these pink profiles here comes from rotational mixing theory that's in the literature and where there is a big inconsistency in mixing levels, but we're measuring them now from the gravity modes. Okay, so this has been done for about 30 stars that you see here in the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. And for these stars, for the Gaia fans in the audience, and to make it clear, I'm a big Gaia fan, but once you're in this mass regime, the Gaia missions results for masses and radii, they rely on stellar models that don't have this type of mixing that we see now from the quakes. So take them with this knowledge that they cannot be perfect because we have to tune towards better mixing descriptions in our interior physics description, right? And so my PhD student, Mai Pedersen, has made a PhD on this. You see her results here, the shrinking convective core as the evolution evolves. This comes straight out of the seismology. It's nice to see that this is somehow confirmed. Yeah, we know that the convective core shrinks as the stars have to evolve. And there is a loose connection that's here between rotation and the level of mixing. Rotational mixing predicts a very tight relation. We see a connection, but the correlation coefficient is 0.6, like it's 60%. So there are other phenomena then rotation that come into play in the real mixing. Okay, I'm gonna have to ask for your patience on this because we are still under review, but I think this is one of the major nice results from astroseismology, and that sets the core masses at the end of the main sequence, and these masses, they determine chemical yields that you see further. I have no time to discuss this other PhD where we have computed this, but if some of you want to understand the predictions that we now have for helium core masses at the end of the hydrogen burning in the core, we have those now also from these mixing. So let me actually stop here by saying that we're swamped with data by the day from the test mission. We couple them to spectroscopy. We prefer all sky spectroscopic measurements. And we're going to go up in the HR diagram towards higher and higher masses, thanks to the test mission that is delivering us magnificent data and with oscillations that you see here. For those of you who want to learn more about this field, there's not only Plato that will come, so the next 10 years are almost guaranteed. And to show that we are actually building it, you see that here. I'm very proud of that. It will take a while, but I'm going to leave you with that and stop here because I've spoken for too long. This is a final slide where I give you some clickable reviews of this modern field that are recent, and I will leave it with that. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you very much, Connie, for a very didactic and fascinating talk. I'm sure there are questions, but online it always takes a little bit before people raise their hands. So I'll ask the first one. And by the way, I should announce you've indeed kindly sent us a link to the PDF of your slides. So I'll circulate that after the talk so that people can actually access those links.
Absolutely.
Yes. So, Saskia has a question. I'll ask mine later. Please, Saskia, go ahead.
I'm not hearing anything.
No, I had to unmute, but I am in Corona pandemic cooking, taking care of kids and listening to a talk. So that took a while. Thank you very much for the very nice talk, Connie. My question is, you have done these simulations to understand the chemical changes due to mixing, to rotation, but as far as I understand, they're for higher mass stars. How would you think they would go towards lower mass stars? Can we extrapolate there, or do you think we have to do this completely anew, this kind of analysis?
Okay, let me go back to my table because I was a bit quick here because of lack of time. So I've actually assembled the information on core masses for all those masses that we have here. And so we can go to, we did this for B stars dominantly, but also for F type stars. And so depending on what you call a high mass and a low mass star, there's always big debates about that when I speak to different communities. But so what we do need is a mass range, as you see here, slightly above the solar mass. These are stars that are slightly evolved, and Georges Angelou has actually reviewed that recently from slightly evolved stars, pressure modes, when they are a bit mixed, let's say, you can also get an inference on the core mass. But we can't have the envelope mixing because we need G modes for that. Yeah, so the lowest masses that we can cover is about 1.3 solar masses. And the highest mass, well, we're moving upwards. And we need more time because TESS is delivering us masses of stars up to 50 solar masses nowadays. Now, these have pressure modes, but these also have mixed modes and gravity modes. So the good news is that, like, from the ground, we thought that these B-type beta CEF stars and higher up were only pressure mode pulsators, but almost all of them also show some gravity modes. And this is going to allow us to probe the mixing near their cores. We are still in the process of finding these stars, of analyzing the light curves, and of the mode identification is the tough part here, right? We have the frequencies, but we must be able to search for patterns to see and label the spherical harmonics to each of the measured frequencies. And we're in that stage, but it's coming. We just need a few more years.
Great, thank you very much.
Okay, Fabian, next question, please go ahead.
Yes, thank you so much. Connie, as usual, a beautiful talk. And I guess you can immediately imagine to which slide I have a couple of questions. just 31 essentially, right? And in particular, you are embargoed results on the envelope diffusion coefficient as a function of sort of the rotation velocity of stars. And I guess you can even anticipate kind of what kind of question I'm going to ask. I wanted to make sure that I understand it correctly, that your diagram is essentially independent of any inclination effects, in particular, if you have really fast rotating stars, but I guess
we are not working with V sin I.
We're exactly
pure rotational tweaking near the core.
And then obviously I would like to know how these diffusion coefficients compare to, let's say, some of the standard mixing recipes like Eddington Sweet. And also I'm extremely intrigued by essentially one data point that you have where almost non-rotating star that has an extremely high diffusion coefficient.
Yes.
Are we seeing something reminiscent of this Hunter diagram here?
Yes, this is a whole lecture by itself. But anyway, let me answer and look at the previous slide. So what we are actually measuring is the level of mixing in this position, because that's where the kernels peak. That's something to keep in mind, yeah? And then you end up with this result where we see a connection with rotation, which is, I mean, you know how critical I have been in the past for rotational mixing. The levels of the mixing coefficients, if you look at this, if I compare that with Geneva or with Bonn or whatever MESA levels, this range between, so we get between 12 and about 8 times 10 to the 5 centimeter squared per second is typically between a factor 100 lower than what you would get for these rotation frequencies if you would turn on the classical rotational mixing with the coefficients that are. So it's not too bad. I mean, it's only a factor 100 less. For me, that is a quite good agreement. But of course, there are stars, and you see this one here, this lower limit. Yeah. There are stars that have very slow rotation and that have very high mixing. Right? And of course, we need to understand that better. It's very uncomfortable for me for the moment to have one outlier, as you call it. For me, I would think it's not going to be an outlier if we have more stars, because we have also compared the quality of these 8 model grids to check which one performs best. If I were to have to pick one theory, which would be the best one? And it's this one where my pointer is, which is going to make some people very upset and others happy. I think in general, it's a good result. Shear mixing seems to be more important than shear mixing added to meridional circulation. But we have too few stars to make this conclusion. We need hundreds of stars. And so I'm happy to discuss offline about this, because I can imagine that this is, for me, this is an important result, because it will have impact on the stellar evolution community of massive stars. But for the moment, this 30 here only goes up to 9 solar masses. It does cover nicely the rotation rate, but this is too few to make very strong inference. We did what we could so far. It's much better than nothing. Huh?
Thank you so much. Absolutely agreed.
So obviously, this type of work is very hard to do for globular clusters, if not impossible. Saskia and I have ongoing conversations about that, actually. But especially when you touched on chemical mixing towards the end, I thought obviously this question of multiple stellar populations in globular clusters is extremely interesting in this context. Can you sketch maybe the steps necessary for towards astroseismological insights into that question over the next maybe couple of years?
Yeah. So globular clusters and TESS is, TESS is made to observe bright stars. Huh? And by the way, this is, if you include mixing, then you don't have a single isochrone, but an isochrone cloud. And this couples to this extended main sequence turnoffs that we tried in this paper, actually, for a young open cluster. Yeah. Now, a globular cluster is even harder, yeah, in terms of detection. But I still would like to encourage you to try, because there's a mission coming up called PLATO, and I had no time to say that. But so far, we have managed to make it open to the community for 8% of the data rate. And like, you know, PLATO is not built to do globular cluster astroseismology. But if there's one mission that's going to be able to do it, it's going to be this one in the near future. Huh? We're building it, as you see, but you have to be patient, right? And so please apply, make predictions. We have the machinery almost in place now, and we're actually right now writing several instrument papers because the design is frozen. And then we also have a very neat PLATO simulator that's actually developed in Leuven. So I encourage you to try and find out for your science case what would be the possibilities. And I'm sure that with Saskia in your place now in the neighborhood there, you can make these predictions very realistic. And then we know how to optimally use PLATO for that kind of research. And so please bombard us with proposals for the, 8% data rate. If you look at the global scenery of PLATO, this connects to typically 40,000 targets, depending on what you want, because you can ask mask targets, or you can do onboard light bursts. But in the global cluster, you want to see the environment to unravel the, it's going to be contamination all over the place. And you're going to have great fun and difficulty to unravel it. But I do advise you to try. I'm afraid that TESS cannot do this. But that's more of a question maybe for Saskia to respond to. The contamination that we are facing is quite extensive. Open clusters, yes. Magellanic Cloud, yes. But global clusters is really stretching it, I think.
Well, one thing that might be interesting also is that globular clusters, of course, were more numerous in the past, and many of them dissolved. Mm-hmm. So there's, for instance, with Gaia, a way of identifying, in combination with spectroscopy and abundances, of identifying former globular cluster stars, then
yes.
Single ones would maybe
be. But that's within reach. Huh? That. But then you need to, you Gaia experts need to tell us where they are, right? And then we can look at them.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Thank you very much. I see Kirill went offline and is now back. So if you would like to ask a question, give it another go.
I still see you as now.
Thanks. Yes. Thanks for a very interesting talk. I learned a lot. I have a question that relates to the gravity modes.
Yes.
Gravity restoring force. So I always wanted to better understand the nature of this restoring force and how it differs from gravitational waves.
Oh.
And so what I'm imagining to happen is that, as you mentioned, it happens, for example, for intermediate mass stars where you have a convective core. And mm-hmm. So the mass displaces, and so I imagine it has the effect on the gravitational potential in that it also starts to oscillate. Mm-hmm. But so is this correct? And how would you how does it?
Yes, I'm losing you, but anyway, I'm assuming you can still hear me, right? So these gravity. Really, I'd like to compare them, even though the analogy is with a grain of salt, but with the waves on the ocean, right? So they are dominantly horizontal in displacement because your restoring force is really gravity and you move in the horizontal direction. Yeah. So in that sense, of course, a real star has all these forces active. Eh? We mathematicians, we like to do asymptotics, but in reality, they're all there, the restoring forces. But it's just a matter of how dominant they are. And so for they are really slow, very slow oscillations. Yeah, and they move in horizontal planes inside your star. So for that reason, they can propagate neatly towards the stellar center. I'm not sure if I can bring up my, this one here. Yeah, well, it's not so clear, but these gravity modes that we see in these type of stars, they have high radial order. So it's neatly slow waves, tiny amplitudes in radial direction, but bigger amplitudes in the horizontal direction. And that means you can mix matter and you're very sensitive to the Coriolis force. So I know that this is less of an intuitive thing compared to sound waves, which we are also familiar with because the pressure is just being pressed and compressed and decompressed in the radial direction. Here it is really buoyancy that is the word that I can attach to it, yeah? But it's not because why do we see them in data? Well, if you look at such a sphere, it's not coming up and down with a big amplitude towards us, but we're looking at the transverse motions here. And so these stars rotate. Yeah. So the Doppler shift is coming towards us and away from us because of the rotation. But on top of that, waves are also traversing horizontally, and that's why we can detect them. So we're mainly probing these parts of these stars where we have gravity modes, and that's why we can still detect them. Some have very large amplitude. In fact, we knew about gravity modes already from ground-based data. Some give millimagnitude brightness variations, right? And typically several kilometers per second. But of course, if you think of an Aurora Lyrae star, it's way bigger radial motions in velocity. But there we see mainly the central part coming at us, right? While here we see the edges of the star coming at us. And because it's so dominantly horizontal, we can still measure it both in velocity and in brightness, okay?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Connie. I would like to suggest that if there are further questions, as usual, now that we have remote joint colloquia, that you either send an email directly to Connie, her email address is right here on the first slide, or to me, but I will circulate the PDF link later with Connie and CC. So I think it should be straightforward to write you directly.
Yes, I welcome that, but you have to be a little bit patient because the next 2 weeks I'm swamped with exams of astroseismology for one thing. Yeah.
Excellent. So also those of you who would like to, for fun, participate in such an exam can drop anymore. Okay, excellent. So of course, I hope that once the corona situation returns to normal, that we'll see you soon again in Heidelberg. I have one more practical announcement to make, for which I will steal the screen share. And that is for next week's joint colloquium, which you see the poster of here, which will be by Filippo Fraternali on going from very nearby stars today, relatively speaking, to the fast rotating and low turbulence disks of high redshift galaxies. Now, with that, I would like to kindly ask everybody to unmute so that, as per colloquium tradition, we can give Connie a very warm thank you, warm applause. Thank you again.